स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट मैग्नेटोस्ट्रिक्शन एंड दिस क्लास इज इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर थर्ड सेमेस्टर डिप्लोमा इलेक्ट्रिकल स्टूडेंट्स. सो वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट मैग्नेटोस्ट्रिक्शन. सो इन आवर लास्ट क्लास वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द हिस्टेरेसिस लूप. सो वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट नाउ मैग्नेटोस्ट्रिक्शन. सो व्हेन फेरोमैग्नेटिक मटेरियल्स आर मैग्नेटाइज्ड, a small change in dimension of the material takes place. So this type of things is more pronounced in case of your ferromagnetic materials only. There is a small extension with corresponding to reduction of cross section of the crystals of which the material is made. When subject to rapidly alternating magnetic fields, there is a rapid and continuous extension and contraction of the material. So students, it is quite usually every ferrous or ferromagnetic material tends to expand and it also tends to contract, and it depends upon its temperature. So this phenomena goes on throughout the material with respect to temperature. So it goes on contracting and expanding. So this is called magnetostriction. Magnetostriction is the major cause of hum in transformer and chokes. So the hum or the magnetic humming sound which you might have heard in case of your transformer, if you have closely listened to the sound of a transformer operating nearby your it can be easily heard in old televisions or else in some transformer particularly, you will find some humming sound will be there. These sounds are due to magnetostrictions. Now soft and hard magnetic materials. So there are materials which can be classified into hard and soft magnetic materials. So we'll discuss how they have been categorized. So all magnetic or ferromagnetic materials can be divided broadly into two groups, that is soft magnetic materials and hard magnetic materials. Materials which have a steeply rising magnetizing curve, relatively small and narrow hysteresis loop, and consequently small energy loss during cycle magnetization are called soft magnetic materials. Soft magnetic materials are therefore employed in building cores for use of alternating magnetic fields. The commonest soft magnetic materials are soft iron, nickel iron alloys, and soft ferrites. So students, these examples you should remember. I should repeat it also. The materials or the commonest soft magnetic materials are soft iron, nickel iron alloys, and soft ferroalloys. So in the diagram, it shows you a typical narrow hysteresis loop. It is marked as ABCDEFA. So a loop will be completed if only and if and only if it will be started by a point and it will end through that point. Here A is the starting point and A is again the ending point, so we can consider it as a loop. Now so this is the diagram of a narrow soft magnetic material. So magnetic materials which have gradually rising magnetizing curve, large hysteresis loop area, and consequently large energy losses for each cycle of magnetization are called hard magnetic materials. So students, how to recognize that it is a material, it is made up of hard magnetic or hard magnetic materials? So if there is a gradual rising magnetizing curve having large hysteresis loop area and consequently large energy losses for each cycle of magnetization, therefore such materials are used for permanent magnets. So this kind of materials will be found for your permanent magnet. We cannot make them temporary magnet because it will not retain magnetism for a longer period of time. So they are recommended for your permanent magnets. Carbon steel, tungsten steel, cobalt steel, alnico, hard ferrites are example of hard magnetic materials. A typical broad hysteresis loop marked LMNPQRL. So here again you can note that L is the starting of the loop and L is again the end of the loop, and the loop is LMNPQRL for a hard magnetic material is shown in the figure 6.7. So students, in this diagram you can easily see the point L, M, N, P, Q, R and again back to L. So it is for your hard magnetic material. Now let us discuss about soft magnetic materials. Soft magnetic materials are used for the construction of cores for electric machines, transformers, electromagnets, reactors, relays, etc. The economic construction of such equipment demands that the magnetic flux should be produced in the minimum space and with minimum losses. We have already known that flux is equal to flux density into cross section area, that is mathematically phi is equal to B into A. So this I should mark it. Yes, phi is equal to B into A. To obtain a given value of the flux, we must choose a high value of flux density in order to keep to the minimum cross section area, means less quantity of material. However, a large flux density means correspondingly large eddy current and hysteresis loss. Furthermore, a value of flux density above the saturation should not be chosen, as this will give rise to large magnetizing current. So in the diagram, saturation value is that value of flux density at which BH curve starts bending and tends to become horizontal. Using a low flux density in order to keep the magnetizing current and the iron loss low will call for increase in cross-sectional area of the magnetic path, which means more iron. So in view of the above discussion, a compromise is made in actual practice while choosing flux density for a given application, in order that the amount of magnetic material used and the iron losses are kept as low as possible. So this is the compromise made while choosing a material. The magnetic material for the core of electrical machines and transformers should have high saturation value and high permeability to keep the magnetizing current within reasonable low limits. When the core is to be used for alternating magnetic fields, the core should be of such a material as to produce small iron losses. To lump sum or sum up the requirements for magnetic materials for use of electric machines and transformers are as follows. So what are they? Small enclosed area of hysteresis loop, high permeability, high saturation value of flux density. The core of electrical machines and transformers must be made of lamination to reduce eddy current losses. Now we will discuss about pure iron. By the term pure iron is meant a ferrous material with an extra low carbon content. The example are low carbon steel and electrolytic iron. In low carbon steel carbons, content is less than 0.1%. By approximate manufacturing technique, high magnetic permeability and low coercive forces can be obtained. However, the resistivity of pure iron is very low, by virtue of which it gives rise to large eddy current losses when operated at high flux densities in alternating magnetic field. This limits their use to fields carrying steady flux or weak alternating current fields. Technically, pure iron is widely used in many kinds of electrical apparatus and instruments as magnetic materials, core of electromagnets, components for relay, electrical instruments, etc. Pure iron is not used in rotating electrical machines, where rotation of the slotted rotor causes variation in reluctance and therefore of flux. Silicon, iron-silicon alloys. Now we will discuss about iron-silicon alloys. In the previous section, it has been explained that the feasibility of application of pure iron is limited. Why it is limited? Because of its high eddy current losses. By incorporating small quantities of another element in iron, good magnetic property are obtained. The chief alloying constitution is silicon, which is added to iron in amounts from about 0.5 to 5% by weight. Extensive use is made of iron silicon alloy usually and are called silicon steel for relatively strong alternating magnetic fields. Generally used is in transformers, electrical rotating machines, reactors, electromagnets and relays. What are reactors? Reactors are basically coils which will increase the inductance value wherever it has been needed. Now, silicon sharply increases the electrical resistivity of iron, thus it decreases the iron loss due to eddy currents. It increases the permeability at low and moderate flux densities, but decreases it at high densities. Addition to silicon to iron reduces the hysteresis losses. The magnetostriction effect is also reduced. Besides improving the magnetic properties of iron, the addition of silicon is also valuable because it facilitates the steel making process. Alloying of low carbon steel with silicon increases the tensile strength. However, it reduces ductility, making steel brittle. This makes silicon alloyed steel difficult to punch and sear. A steel with more than 5% of silicon may be too hard and brittle to be easily workable. It has been already explained that in all the cases where iron cores are worked in varying magnetic fields, the magnetic material must be laminated to keep down to the minimum eddy current losses. To satisfy these needs, iron silicon alloy is produced in the form of thin sheets. The brittleness of sheet steel can be easily tested by bending a strip of steel through 180 degree in both directions a number of times by holding in a vise. The industries have tables which show number of bends that steels of various thickness should withstand before breaking. The introduction of silicon in steel was an important development in the past when iron was used in the core material in the form of sheets. The material gradually deteriorated due to repeated heating and cooling. With increasing deterioration, the hysteresis losses also increases. It was then necessary to take out the core and re-anneal it at periodic intervals. These difficulties has been completely overcome by using silicon steel at a core material. So now students, it has been mentioned that in the section that the addition of silicon increases permeability. So by adding silicon, the permeability of the material is increased at low and moderate flux densities. This means that high silicon steel has high permeability but comparatively lower saturation. High silicon steel with a silicon content of about 4% is usually chief in the magnetic circuits of power transformers, which operates at a flux density of about 1 Weber per meter square. However, since the cores of rotating electrical machines are slotted with the teeth having small cross-section area, the flux density in the teeth is much higher. To obtain high flux density in the case of silicon steel, the magnetizing current necessary is very large. Also, punching slot in high silicon steel would be difficult. Because it is harder and more brittle, more these reasons, low silicon steel with a silicon content of about 2% having higher saturation value is used in a core of electrical rotating machines. A comparative study of the magnetizing curve of silicon, high silicon and low silicon steel is in the table or in the figure 6.9. So from this figure, we conclude that if we will go for high silicon steel, it will saturate at a lower values. So we have to go for low value silicons so as to reach the accurate or best results. The most common thickness of electrical sheet steel is making cores of electrical transformer ranges from 0.35 mm to 0.5 mm. Thinner lamination of as small as 0.1 mm are used in high frequency equipment. So in our next class, students, we will read about grain oriented steel. So thank you for watching.